You know, when you get to know people, you get to know how they communicate and, you know, kind of what patterns of speech or little mannerisms people have. And I think certainly when you have a pastor for a while, you get to know there's certain things they say over and over, or kinds of analogies they use over and over. Recently, it was actually Pelly. You know, we were hanging out at one of these men's beer buddies nights, and he said, you talk about Star Wars a lot. And I was like, yeah, you have me pegged. I talk a lot about Star Wars. But I remember growing up when we went to this church. My dad's a pastor, and when we went there, he became the pastor. But before that, there had been this old fellow named Ken Krieger, great, great old guy. And he had been the founding pastor in the 50s of this community in Anaheim, California, great church. And he was, you know, apparently a really good pastor. But like everyone, he had his mannerisms. I didn't get to experience it very much because by the time I came, you know, my dad was mostly preaching. But he would preach every once in a while, and people would share that when it came to Pastor Krieger and it was time for like a good sermon illustration or a metaphor, all roads led to peanuts. And when I mean peanuts, I mean like Charlie Brown peanuts. Like every sermon virtually that people ever heard, and he had this great kind of old-fashioned pastor's voice, well, Lucy said to Charlie Brown. And so all metaphors went through Lucy and Charlie Brown. But this is how people are. You know, none of us can invent the wheel all the time, and we have ways of saying things, and even when we're not pastors, right, we have our favorite sayings and whatever. And people have sometimes asked, biblical scholars, you know, when we think about Jesus, what was Jesus's main theme? Like, what was his Charlie Brown or Star Wars metaphor that he used over and over? And when we look at the Bible, and these people do, the best we can tell, the primary sermon that Jesus liked to preach again and again was that the kingdom of God or the kingdom of heaven has come near, right? Repent, for the kingdom of God has come near. The kingdom of heaven has come here. And if you go through the Gospels, you'll find from the beginning of his ministry, pretty much all the Gospels agree, this is what he started preaching, and he keeps preaching it throughout his Gospels, and then he's preaching it till the very end. And so this is the metaphor that if you want to kind of have a good understanding of what the Gospel is, we have to, as Christians, kind of think about, well, what does it mean for a God's reign to be a kingdom, and what does it mean for it to be near? And so if we think about what a kingdom is, this is a little bit harder for us to understand than it was back then because, you know, the language of kingdom in many ways speaks to a kind of rule that isn't as common now, right? There aren't too many kingdoms with kings, right? A kingdom is a place, a land that is ruled by some sort of royal person, and so it's a place with a king and a way of life. You know, I don't know if any of you are big UK Anglophiles. There's been this thing with Meghan Markle and Prince Harry. There is a kingdom there. It's actually kind of just ceremonial, right? The queen doesn't just get to demand what she wants. But, you know, we can still see in some ways there's a kingdom there, right? Because Meghan and Harry want to kind of back away from some of the royal stuff. And it's a huge deal, right, if you followed any of this news, because that's not the way our kingdom is, right? If you're a royal, you have to do these things. And so that gives us a little bit of a hint of what a kingdom is. A kingdom's a place with leaders who have a certain way of seeing the world and a certain way of behaving. So that's a little bit of a hint in modern times, but of course in ancient times, the language of kingdom was just what they would say for another nation or country, right? Pretty much everywhere was a kingdom with some sort of ruler, some sort of Caesar or king or chief or whatever. And if we look back in Jesus's day, people would have understood the language of kingdom because they could look through their history in Israel and see kingdom after kingdom that they had engaged with. And mostly these were very negative experiences, right? We can go way back to the time of Moses and the Israelites who end up enslaved by a kingdom in Egypt, right? You had the Pharaoh who didn't want to let the people go and who used the Israelites as slaves. So there was a kingdom. We have later in the Bible, they've escaped to the promised land, they build this temple, life is going on, but as we hear, they're often not very faithful, they start worshiping other gods, and pretty soon this new kingdom called the Babylonians come in, and they completely destroy the temple, if you remember that story. They wipe out almost everything, and they take a lot of the rulers and the educated people, and they take them to Babylon. That's called the Babylonian exile. So that was an experience of a kingdom, right? This really brutal empire that came in and mostly wipe them out. And then by the time we get to Jesus, we have the kingdom of Rome, right? Rome is the ruler from the city of Rome where Caesar resides. And the way Rome would rule is they would have kind of puppet masters around. And by the time of Jesus, the puppet masters were called the Herods. There was two Herods, and they were ruling in Rome's place on behalf of Rome, taxing and doing all the things that empires do. And so, you know, people in Israel were pretty familiar with what a kingdom was, but they were also familiar with it because they had lived it in their own country too. There's an interesting thing with kings and kingdoms in the Old Testament, where we see after the Jews came to the Promised Land, there's this time where they didn't really have kings. They had different kind of prophetic leaders, and they'd call them judges, but they didn't have a king. And all the other nations had kings. And there's this funny conversation that goes on in one of the books where God is saying, you know, you really don't want a king. And the people are like, no, we want a king, right? They have a king over in Assyria and Egypt, and we feel like we want a king, right? They have something we don't have. And God's actually debating them through his prophets. He's saying, you know, if you get a king, the king's going to be selfish, and he's going to tax you heavily, and he's going to send your children off to war in ways that aren't good for you. And they say, we don't care. We want a king. And so eventually, he gives them kings. And you know, there's a few of the famous ones like David and Solomon and Saul. But basically, even though once in a while the kings do something good, most of the history of Jewish kings is one disaster after another, right? People turning their back on God, people you know, doing awful things with the people and getting in stupid wars. And so God ends up being right. But a few hundred years before Jesus, there come to be these prophets who start predicting that someday there will be a new king who will come. And instead of being this worldly king who's just interested in their own ego and power and wars and money, this king is going to be a representative of God who will rule in God's place. We hear a little of that in the book of Matthew when we heard, you know, the nations have heard, seen a great light. You know, out of the darkness comes one who's going to come. And so there's this prediction of a king that's coming to reign in God's place in the way that God would actually want. And so today in our gospel reading, along comes Jesus, and here is his sermon, right, that we're talking about. The kingdom of heaven, or the kingdom of God, has come near. And what's interesting is he, you know, like I said, he doesn't just preach us once and explain it once and move on to the next theme. He repeatedly, throughout his life, feels the need to preach this message, which I think tells us two things. One is that it's very important, and two, you don't have to explain things over and over unless you think it's really hard to understand. And if you look at many of the gospel stories, they begin with the phrase, the kingdom of God is like this, right? And then, you know, there's a story or a metaphor to try to unpack for us what this kingdom is like. And we find some interesting teachings, right? Some of the classic teachings of Jesus, that in the kingdom of God, the first are last and the last are first. So kind of this idea of an upside down thing of where people are in society. The blessed are the poor and those who are struggling. We hear that in the kingdom of God, we're called to love our enemies and pray for them when they persecute us. We're called to be radically generous when people ask us for help. And what's really weird about the kingdom of God is when Jesus comes, and by the time we get to like Palm Sunday, people are expecting that Jesus, yes, this is the Messiah who's coming to save the world. But you imagine what they are imagining is the kind of king they knew, right? The king of God is coming, and maybe he's going to start a revolution and overthrow the Romans, or maybe he's going to get an army and kind of wipe out the people who are oppressing us. And yet, instead of vanquishing his enemies, the king, who we call Jesus, allows himself to be killed by his enemies. Which, you know, we're in political season, right? I don't know of any other politician who says, I'm going to win by dying, right? It's not a very good winning strategy. But the New Testament doesn't have a problem with this. In fact, it describes when Jesus is on the cross, right? He's wearing this crown of thorns, and it describes it as his enthronement, his coronation, that he's being lifted up as he's on the cross, which is this really paradoxical thing that's hard for humans to understand. Why? Dying is the time when you become king. So what do we take from all this? Well, there's a Christian writer named Brian McLaren who says, you know, that this kingdom of God stuff is an announcement. But he says, we have made the announcement of the reign of God into an evacuation plan into another world. So what he's trying to say is that, you know, frequently with Christians, we have turned Christianity, the entire message, into this heaven-focused faith, where the whole goal of life in the world is to escape life in the world, right? As if all God wants to do is send us to heaven. So we hear the kingdom of heaven, and we think, oh, God wants to send us to heaven after we die. And don't get me wrong. I mean, I believe in an afterlife. This is a core piece of the gospel. And certainly, you know, this promise that someday there will be an age to come where all things will be put right is part of the gospel. And in fact, sometimes it's the only good news we have when a loved one dies. So I don't want to diminish that at all. But the fact is that this is not especially what Jesus is preaching about today. Because as you'll notice, he's telling people who are still in this world that the joys and the problems they're facing, which we face in everyday life, he's saying that the kingdom of heaven has come near now. He doesn't say after you die, the kingdom of heaven has come near. The kingdom of heaven has come here now. And the point seems to be that Jesus is sharing that you don't have to wait to die in order to experience God's presence. We can experience it now. Which is why we're people of faith in the first place who gather together, right? We gather in worship to have an experience of God. We pray to have an experience of God. We serve to have an experience of God. And Jesus' advice on how you experience God, how you experience the kingdom, is he says, repent, right? Repent, for the kingdom of God has come near. Now, I think I've talked about this before, but repent is a often misunderstood word in our culture because we put a lot of baggage to it. We often think of it mainly as having to do with feeling really guilty and just kind of saying to God over and over, oh God, I'm so sorry and I'm so awful and I'm just this awful sinner. You know, I'm sorry, you know, please forgive me. As if that's the attitude of repentance, just this kind of pathetic, never-ending guilt cycle. Well, that kind of remorseful attitude may be a good first step. It may even sometimes be necessary if we've done something wrong that we feel guilty about. But actually, that's not the primary meaning of the word repentance. The literal meaning of word repentance, it's a compound word that means, it's metanoia, which means mind beyond, which has to do with this idea of changing our mind, of thinking bigger, of being willing to let God kind of change the way we perceive the world. And so living in the kingdom is not being this kind of miserable, guilty person. It's not also about just trying to leave this world for heaven. Living in the kingdom is more a certain kind of consciousness. It's about where your heart and mind is. It's about how you perceive, how you prioritize things. It's about where you're seeking fulfillment. It's about how you view God and neighbor. And going back to the language, the kingdom is about remembering who and what your king is, right? What rules your life. One of my other favorite writers, Richard Rohr, writes, "The price of real transformation is high. It means that we have to change our loyalties from power, success, money, ego, and control to the imitation of a vulnerable God where servanthood, surrender, and simplicity reigns." And he goes on to say, when Christians say, come Lord Jesus, or Jesus is Lord, we are actually announcing our commitment to Jesus' upside down world where the last are first and the first are last over any other power system or frame of reference. If Jesus is Lord, then Caesar is not. If Jesus is Lord, then the economy and the stock market are not. If Jesus is Lord, then my house, my possessions, my country, and my job are not. If Jesus is Lord, then I am not. So to say Jesus is Lord, to be involved with the kingdom, is to kind of come to understand and embrace this upside down world where Christ is king, where the poor are rich, where forgiveness is offered and enemies are loved, where we give freely to those who need help, and where we love God and each other generously, just as we've been generously loved. And pretty soon after Jesus announces this kingdom, and he's going to keep on teaching about it, he meets some random fishermen who seem to have the qualities, the qualifications for nothing in particular but to catch fish. And he tells these people of all people, follow me. And as we'll see, the rest of their lives are going to be this journey, which is going to be joyful and inspiring, but also a struggle to figure out what it means to live in Jesus' upside-down kingdom. And sometimes living in that kingdom is a struggle. You know, as we hear from the Corinthians, they're all fighting, and Peter and Paul has to come along and say, stop it, right? The call to Christ is the call to be united. But you know, as much as Jesus' vision might feel like a challenge, I hope it doesn't feel completely absent from your life, like it's something you don't know. Because actually, when we look around, I mean, there are endless examples of people giving of themselves and giving of their lives to serve others, to love God. You know, every week here at Community of Joy, we have this announcement time, and it always runs kind of long because there's just so many things happening in this community. I mean, we hear about there's food collections for the poor. We hear about the youth are raising money, and you guys are nice enough to support them because you want to give them an experience of God in their faith. We talk about, you know, food, Sunday school that's happening, and Father Ray teaching. And every week when I'm here, you guys aren't always here during the week, but there's always groups meeting here, Bible study groups and service groups and all kinds of things. There's just an incredible amount of self-giving and people coming to experience God. Sometimes we don't think about it. Sometimes we don't put that in terms of the kingdom of God reigning in our hearts, but that's exactly what it is. It's God becoming present in our lives and teaching us to give of ourselves. And so as we think about this message, where do we hear that invitation to follow me? Where do we feel that little nudge? It doesn't have to be a scream. It's not a guilt trip. But where is that nudge that God is inviting us to follow him into that kingdom? Where are we being called to let go of something that we don't always want to let go of? Where are we being called to love and serve our neighbor? Where are we being called to deepen our faith in some way that can also make a difference for others? The kingdom of God is near. You don't have to wait till heaven to experience it. And so hear the invitation of Christ to come and follow. Amen.